Bach wrote cantatas for just about every kind of occasion and on a wide number of subjects, including such unlikely ones as the love of coffee. Weddings played a large part in his professional life, so of course did funerals. And funerals brought in good money. This is why he used to complain, not entirely seriously, if there were long spells of good weather in winter. More people died in a hard winter, which meant more money for everyone in the funeral business. And Bach had earned the right to make jokes about it the hard way. Of his 20 children, 10 had died by the time he was 55. Few things are more frustrating for the Bach biographer than the total disappearance of all the letters he ever wrote to members of his immediate family and of theirs to him. True, he was seldom away for very long after the time of his first marriage, but there were the odd exceptions. One was the trip to Carlsbad with Prince Leopold, from which he returned to find that his wife had died. Another was a visit to Berlin in 1741 to visit his son Carl Philipp Emanuel. And here history looked horribly like repeating itself. Bach received a letter from Leipzig saying that Anna Magdalena, who was pregnant, just as Maria Barbara had been, was very dangerously ill. Fearing the worst, he hurried back to Leipzig and was overjoyed to find his wife still living, but she was very much weakened and her recovery was slow. A month later, she wrote to a relative, regretfully cancelling a planned visit.
Most noble sir, most highly respected Sir Chamberlain, highly esteemed patron. Your most highly honoured letter of September the 8th, most noble sir, worked such a change in my spirits that it almost, if not completely, made me forget the most acute pains of the body, since in it you give me and my household the strongest assurance of your honour's invaluable favour through your kind invitation. But my past and continuing sickly condition robs me, alas, of such pleasant hours, and the advice of my family forbids me to undertake such a journey, on which, in their opinion, might hinge either a noticeable improvement or the complete ruin of my health. If, meanwhile, your honour should kindly grant our repeated prayer, and should graciously honour our house with your honour's most esteemed and desired presence, I assure your honour that for us all the greatest pleasure would spring therefrom. I remain, my lifelong, and with most obedient compliments, your honour's most humbly devoted servant, Anna Magdalena Bach.
As the principal copyist of her husband's works, Anna Magdalena developed a musical handwriting which was almost indistinguishable from Bach's own. It would seem that the same thing applied to her style as a letter writer. As husband, father, teacher, and friend, Bach was big-hearted, generous, even gregarious, and full of humour. But, unsurprisingly, especially remembering that street brawl with Geiersbach back in Arnstadt, he had a volcanic temper, especially when confronted by incompetence in people who should know better.
On one occasion, the organist of the Thomaskirche, who was in a general way a worthy artist, so enraged him by a mistake on the organ during the rehearsal of a cantata that Bach tore the wig from his own head and, with the thundering exclamation, "You should have been a cobbler," threw it at the organist's head.
But we are not told what happened next, nor do we know why Bach was so fond of cobbler as a term of abuse, which he apparently was. The fact is, though, that even with his volatile temper, Bach was a born teacher. Whether he was a born schoolteacher is another matter, but in the testimony of those who studied with him individually, as in the treasury of masterpieces that he wrote for instructive purposes, the impression of a truly great teacher is unavoidable. One of his many indebted pupils was the composer Johann Kirnberger.
The method of teaching is the best I have ever encountered, for he proceeds steadily, step by step, moving gradually from the easiest to the most difficult. And as a result, even the step to the fugue has only the difficulty of passing from one step to the next. It is on this ground that I hold the method of Bach to be the best and only one. How sad it is that this great man never wrote anything theoretical about music, and that his teachings have reached posterity only through his pupils.
Not so, Mr. Kirnberger. As Ernst Ludwig Gerber reveals in a reminiscence of his father, who was also a pupil of Bach's.
Bach treated my father with particular kindness because he came from Schwarzburg, and always thereafter called him his compatriot. He promised to give my father the instruction he desired, and asked at once whether he had industriously played fugues. At the first lesson, Bach set before him his own two-part inventions. When he had studied these through to Bach's satisfaction, there followed a series of suites, and then the well-tempered clavier. This latter work Bach played altogether three times through for him with his unmatchable art, and my father counted these among the happiest hours of his life, when Bach, under the pretext of not feeling in the mood to teach, sat himself at one of his fine instruments and thus turned these hours into minutes.
All the supreme instrumentalists have taught by example, but Bach did more than that. He taught through his own compositions, many of which were expressly conceived for educational purposes. He didn't need to write a theoretical treatise. He put everything he knew into his music, and he made no distinction between learning and joy. His short preface to the 2- and 3-part inventions not only demonstrates Kirnberger's point about the methodical advancement, one step at a time, it tells us something absolutely vital about Bach's music generally and how he wanted it to sound. In a lengthy subtitle, he describes the collection in his own very characteristic way.
Upright instruction, wherein the lovers of the clavier, and especially those desirous of learning, are shown a clear way, not alone to learn to play clearly in two voices, but also, after further progress, to deal correctly and well with three parts. Furthermore, at the same time, not alone to have good inventiones, ideas, but to develop the same well, and above all, to arrive at a singing style in playing.